This is Easy Does It Barbecue with your host, Dan McDonald, owner of Colorado Barbecue Outfitters. If you're ready to dig into some serious talk about all things barbecue, from the moo to the oink, grab a cold one and let's get down to business. Now, here's Dan McDonald.
Hey, everybody. You're listening to the Easy Does It Barbecue Show. We call it Easy Does It Barbecue because we usually talk about the easiest ways to do it. Today, we're going to delve into an interesting topic, and a lot of you have asked me to cover this topic at the store, which is also the sponsor of the show, Colorado Barbecue Outfitters. And we had Brian Guerrero on about a month or so ago, and he talked about the differences between backyard barbecue and competition barbecue. And just to reintroduce Brian, Brian is a man of many hats. He has a barbecue competition team called BBQ 22 and competes locally throughout the state. He also owns his own business, Guerrero Concrete, here in the Colorado Springs area. And he's also a sales rep, one of my vendors. One of the products I sell at the store are Green Mountain Grills, wood pellet grills. And Brian is my sales rep and helps me out with that and keeps me stocked. So, Brian, thanks for coming to the show today.
Hey, great. Thanks for having me on.
So we brought you back because a lot of people wanted to hear about your competition experience. And, you know, like I told you, a lot of us see it on TV, but a lot of times they're already set up on TV. We don't get to see the kind of nitty gritty, what's the planning like? You know, where do you get things? How do you prepare, say, a week in advance for a said competition? And then maybe talk about some of the competitions that are coming up that you are having to plan for. So, yeah, let's start with that. So, you know you've got a competition coming up.
Yeah, we have a competition coming up in early August in Alamosa, and then the week after is going to be Milliken up in Milliken, Colorado. The biggest thing I would honestly say is preparation. Preparation is 80% of the competition world by far. My week leading up to competitions, I normally start shopping on Mondays and Tuesdays. Fridays, when I do my chicken, for instance, I'll order a case of chicken on Friday, and usually it's ready to go Monday afternoon. So then Monday afternoon, I'll pick my chicken up. If there's time to go get my pork products, I will. If not, I'll do those on a Tuesday to shop. I typically smoke 4 pork butts, and even my ribs, they come in 2 packs. So I usually get 3 packets. So I'll get 6 ribs, but I only cook 4 for competition. So all the extra meat that I do get, I just food saver it, put it in the freezer and save it for another day of practice time or something like that.
Yeah.
But so typically Tuesdays, I already have my chicken. So it's either sometimes I do it in the morning, like 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, and it's nice and quiet. So between both days, I'll do pork and chicken and food saver them and get them in the fridge. Wednesdays predominantly are my injections and all my sauces in the evening. Another thing that I've found is to pace your time, and really do time management is really key. So usually Wednesdays are sauces. Thursdays, a lot of competitions, you can get there at 3 o'clock in the afternoon on Thursday afternoon. So usually when I get off work on Thursday, I'm just come up, hook up to the trailer, and then I go ahead and take off. And usually we can stay there at the competition Thursday night because they're predominantly around here, say 2 to 3 hours travel time one way. So then that way Friday morning, but pretty much ready to go. I'm pretty much there.
Talk to us about your trailer. Walk us through what's in that trailer.
My trailer, obviously it's got smokers and coolers and shelves and stuff in it, but I've got a basic 6x14 covered trailer. I cook on Gateway drum smokers, so I got 3 cans that go in there. I've got my Green Mountain Grill pellet grill that does brisket. That's in there. And then I got a big cooler that I just got ice chunks in, and that's kind of my refrigeration to put my meat and stuff in. And then, of course, you know, I got another little cooler that's just designed for my my sauces and my injections. I mean, everything that I pretty much use is, you know, 28-ounce mason jars that I store everything in. So they all fit nice and snug in one of my coolers there. Basically, on the Sundays before, if I haven't gotten to it, Sundays are pretty designated to just make sure all the cookers are clean. I do not like cooking on a dirty pit. It just, for me, it kind of makes a really funky taste on the food. So I scrub them down, and it's about a 3-hour process just to make sure all my cookers are clean. And then they're strapped in. I mean, I got an easy track system in my cover trailer that I got, you know, bungee cords and ratchet down ties that I have them all tied down and stuff. So that way, pretty much the cookers are in there on Sundays. And then as the week goes on, I mean, like my big coolers, I predominantly just have them in my garage. And as I get a project done, then, you know, prepping meat, I just go ahead and either put it in a cooler or my outdoor fridge and stuff. Basically, and then just pretty much go over, you know, I got a couple Tupperwares that I have all just strictly competition stuff in. My knives, my
utensils and all that.
Utensils, yeah. Oil separators.
Brian, real quick, I want to go back. You made a comment, and I get this question comes up at the store constantly. I get asked this, and if you Google this subject, you will find probably no less than hundreds of ways. But you mentioned you clean your smokers.
Mm-hmm.
Tell the listeners, what do you do? How do you clean them?
How do I clean them? Okay, my cans, for instance, I pull all the grates out. Pull the firebox out, pull the diverter shield out, get the oven degreasers. They come in 3-packs. Usually one bottle will clean all my cookers for the day and stuff. So the cans, for instance, take me a couple hours to do.
So you're cleaning inside and out?
Inside and out.
Okay.
Yeah.
How far are you on the inside? How are you stripping it right down to brand new?
Yep.
You're leaving. Oh, you are?
Yeah, I'm taking it all the way down to, yeah, it's a
surprising.
It's a seasoned pit. So, I mean, you know, I don't have a lot of creosote.
You're just staying on top of it.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, you know, as you adventure into this world, you know, in the days that you are at competitions, you know, you notice the guys that do well, the guys that are hit and miss. The hit and miss guys, they're the ones that are constantly showing up with dirty grills or, you know, creosote buildup grills. And I'm one that is very finicky. You run a clean fire, you have your rubs and you have your sauces, and that's what you want to predominantly focus your flavors on, because you get all that creosote, then I mean, once it starts getting up to a certain temperature, you know, that stuff just starts melting and caking and
turns into a goo,
funky odor.
And I think I speak for a lot of people that I imagine people listening to this out there might be surprised, because a lot of us here, you know, it's seasoning, right? That you're seasoning the smoker, and the more gunk that you leave on there, flavors. And you know, what we're hearing today is actually the competition guys, for the most part, it seems like, Brian, you're telling us the successful ones are doing just the opposite. They're keeping them very clean. That's interesting.
They're doing very, very clean.
Okay.
I mean, grates to, you name it.
I'll be darned.
And basically, it's, you know, the degreaser, I spray it in there. You know, the grates are spotless. And then once everything is washed and cleaned and towel dried, let it air dry for a little bit. And then I just go in with some canola spray, and I just respray everything.
Okay, yeah.
And stuff, and it's not the most glamorous part of the project.
Yeah, but it works.
Or the hobby and stuff, but to always have consistency with your flavors. Because I think a lot of people don't realize, too, that creosote buildup, you know, whatever rub you're doing, you know, you start tasting that rub out, you know, you open the rub for the first time, you taste it with your finger. Hey, this is pretty good. I like this stuff. This is what I want to use. But when you start smoking in with all that creosote actually overpowers the rub. So basically all you're tasting is pretty much a dirty pit and stuff. And there's as sensitive and these judges flavor palettes are. You know, they can tell right off the bat, and it's, you kind of look like a guy that wasn't really prepared.
Uh-oh.
Basically, and stuff. So, yeah, it's not uncommon. I mean, guys don't obviously clean them there at the competition, but oh yeah, we're all cleaning our pits and
that's
stuff.
That's interesting to know. Yeah. Okay, so just real quickly a recap. You start literally like over a week before, as far as prepping. You've got your trailer, which you've been doing it now. How long have you been competing against since
2017?
17. Okay, so you've been doing this long enough. Mm-hmm. Your trailer's all set up, ready to go for the most part, right? I mean,
exactly.
You've got your equipment in there, your canopy and whatever.
Yeah.
Okay.
I got everything stored in there. I mean, there's people that put shelves and cabinetry in there. And if that's what you want to do, I try and keep things as less cluttered as possible.
Yeah.
There's a lot of times that you're just, you know, you're doing something and you just got to grab something real quick. Because you got to remember, a lot of times you're on time frames. You're not at home just nonchalantly cooking.
Yeah.
And
that's another question that I've been asked to ask you is, you get there, you've drove 3 hours to Alamosa, let's say, and you forgot something. Are teams willing to loan things to other teams, or is it so competitive that you are just on your own at that point?
You know,
how does that work?
For the most part, matter of fact, ironic you say that, because my second time in Alamosa, I had one bag of pellets that I took with me, and I knew I was just going to cook brisket on my pellets. And we entered the people's choice part of it, which I knew that I was going to just cook, you know, overnight before my brisket. I put my brisket on, but I knew I wasn't going to have enough pellets. And so the next door neighbor talked to him, and I was like, hey, do you need anything from the store? I got to go get some pellets and stuff. And he's like, I got an extra bag of pellets here. So I gave him $20 and he gave me a bag of pellets kind of thing. But, you know, for the most part, you know, guys are pretty helpful.
Yeah, there's good camaraderie, it seems like, between most of them.
And there again, what was it? I remember my very first competition. That's the gentleman, Matt Heath. You cued me all night long. My very first competition in Pueblo. I was up and starting my cans, and Matt was right next to me, and he was trying to fire his cans at the same time, and it actually, his lighter, he forgot to put new lighters in his trailer for the season.
Oh, no.
He pulled out three lighters and none of them worked. And I mean, he was just looking like, you know, really distraught. And I was like, is there something you need there? And he just looked at me, and I just walked over and I gave him a lighter and stuff. And he got him going and stuff. And lo and behold, he took first place overall grand champion in the competition and stuff.
That's
so
great. Yeah.
After he got his award money and prizes and stuff, I walked up to him and I was like, so is half of that mine now? He goes, no, I got things to pay for, but I can give you a Coke.
Yeah, there you go.
I drank a Coke with him after and congratulated. But
oh, that's good.
Yeah, you know, and sometimes, I mean, some places you need an extra 50 foot of hose to fill up your RV tank or whatever.
Yeah.
If guys have it, they will.
Yeah.
You know, if you need an extra extension cord or an injector or something.
For the most part,
I mean, guys are really
good. Well, I think a lot of the general public, us, and I'm referring to myself as well, backyard barbecuers, you know, we watch these the barbecue pit masters and the reality shows. I call them reality shows because I do think they're a little fluffed up than what's really out there. And a lot of times, I think because it's called competition, they seem to emphasize that. And I wonder, I mean, I've never competed, but I've been to them.
Mm-hmm.
And I've never personally witnessed like that much hardcore competition, I guess, you know, where they're really getting into it. I wonder how much of that is fluff for TV or if that really goes on.
Honestly, TV, the time and when you're cooking and the decisions you have to make on the fly, that just comes with experience and cooking at home. I mean, you know, you're normally, for instance, you got a piece of meat that you know that's done in 3 hours. Sometimes it's not done in 3 hours. It's 3.5 hours. So, you know, you have to make that judgment call. Hey, do I, you know, kick it up from 250 to 275 to hurry up and you know, just give it that last kiss to get over the top. But so those are just a lot of judgment calls when you're cooking, because like I said, you know, turn-in times on Saturdays, you have to, if you don't get it in there on that time, they just turn you away and you just missed out on that category.
How strict are they on that? Are we talking a second past, or is there a grace period?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, if it's due at a particular time, it literally, if you're seconds late, you're disqualified?
Yeah.
Really?
And typically how that goes is, okay, your four meats, and we'll just start them out. Chickens at 12 o'clock sharp. Is, you know, what they say. Now, you have a 10-minute window. And what I mean by 10-minute window is the table opens at 11:55 to turn your chicken in. And that goes till 12:05. So you have a 10-minute window literally right there. Now,
so you cannot turn it in earlier than 11:55.
Correct.
Oh, so and every team is literally turning everything in 10 minutes?
In 10 minutes.
Wow, okay.
So
I didn't know that.
Yeah, now at 12:05, you know, they take the trays off the table, and if you're, you know, running and you're 10 feet away, sorry.
Yep, you know, too bad. Oh, now, that's got to be disappointing.
Yeah, and I've known some
all
guys.
All that work.
Some guys are just walking with their head down.
Oh, I bet. Boxes.
But there again, you know, some of these competitions, there's a lot of, you know, the bigger events, the 60, 70 team kind of tournaments, you know, they'll have lines in front of that table, for instance, you know, and if you're in line and they know that you've, because, they have, you know, there's at a table, there's probably about 4 or 5 KCBS reps right there.
Mm-hmm.
So they know if they see you standing in line and it goes to 12:06, but they knew you've been in line since 12:03.
That makes sense.
They're going to say, you know, yes, you can put your food down and stuff.
Yeah. You're listening to the Easy Does It Barbecue Show. We call it Easy Does It Barbecue because we usually talk about the easiest ways to do it. Brian, thanks for coming to the show today. Well, let's get back to when you actually, a lot of times you'll leave Thursday, stay Thursday night.
Mm-hmm.
And then Friday is Friday just prep day, actual cook day, or do you cook Saturday, or both?
It really, here's the most general part about it. Okay, you can be there on Thursdays, you get your meat inspection on Fridays starting at around 9 a.m., and they'll go till all the teams are there.
Yeah.
You know, I've found that I personally like to be there as early as possible. The spots are designated already. So the event organizers, they already know where they're going to place you. Okay. Usually your spot that you pay for $250 is like a 20 by 30 spot.
Can you request a spot, or are you just at their mercy?
And some of them you can request
spots. They do. Okay. Because I often wonder, do teams sometimes, just because they're friends, do they request to be near each other?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, okay. All right. Interesting.
You see that quite a bit and stuff if you want to.
Otherwise, it's just pick of the draw.
Pick of the draw right there. Now, with us, because my dad, he takes his fifth wheel, and of course, I have the covered trailer that I worked out of, we always need a 20 by 40 spot. So they've got up to 40 feet. And I'll be honest, predominantly, if you need 45 feet, 43 feet, I mean, they're usually pretty lenient about that kind of stuff. But then, of course, actually, that's like an extra $25 to get extra space and stuff. So, I mean, that 20 by 40 spot, if you could park your truck in that spot too, you can have it. Or there's designated spots that are pretty secure. These events, the most that I've seen is, you know, security starts at like 8 in the morning on Friday, and it goes all the way up through Saturday after the award ceremony. I like to get there Thursday, Friday morning I set up. And I really try and keep it to where I only have about an hour and a half of setup at the very most. Sometimes I can get done in an hour just because, you know, you don't want to get too tired. I mean, you don't want to be sitting there setting up for 3 hours, because you got to remember, at the end of the contest, you got to break it all down and take it home with you. So, you know, sometimes it's not only that, you never know. You might get a freak rainstorm come in. And, you know, if you got 3 hours of tearing stuff down, you get a rainstorm, it can make for a long evening kind of thing.
I can imagine.
But so yeah, typically get everything to try and get things set up Thursday night. If not, then first thing Friday morning. Then when they come around and inspect meat, I'm one that likes to prep brisket Fridays at the competition. So just a process I like to do. And then probably after lunch kind of thing, you know, grab a sandwich after brisket and after they've checked the meat, make me a sandwich and some chips kind of thing, and start brining my chicken, which goes for a couple hours. But, you know, the time there, the more you prep during the week and the less you have to do on Friday, you'll see that it's not a very stressful situation.
Yeah, that would just seem like it makes sense, yeah.
It's when you leave everything for the last minute to do. Or, I mean, I've seen teams out there, and that's just what they do.
Some people thrive on that.
Thrive on it, or unfortunately, they, you know, they try to do it during the week.
Yeah.
They just don't have time. I mean, we're all regular people at heart.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody's got their own busy lives kind of thing. So I've seen people literally prep from the time they get there to the, you know, time to go to bed, they're still prepping meat and stuff. Yeah. But yeah, think about it, you know, you're pretty tired after that and stuff. That's why it's important to, you know, during the week, I like to do every day, except for Sundays, because they're cleaning, 2 hours a night. 2 hours Monday goes to the competition, 2 hours Tuesday. So basically, I'm pacing myself as the week goes that way. And, you know, whenever you get into it, you know, it might take you a couple competitions to figure out, okay, this is what works for me, this is what doesn't, kind of thing. But the best thing I can do that way you don't get burnt out is just designate 2 hours a day. And 2 hours a day, you'll be fine and stuff, you know, once you start doing a couple of these and stuff. But the biggest thing is just, you know, to have an initiative, have a drive. Don't be intimidated. There's a lot of, you know, big names, fancy trailers, fancy expensive cookers, but at the end of the day, you always got to remember these guys started out at the
just like everybody else
else and stuff. So typically, you know, I only do the brisket in the morning. I brine my chicken, and shoot, I mean, usually Fridays are really kickback days. You can really make them kickback days where, you know, you're there, you're set up. You only got a couple little minor things to do. I mean, you know, sometimes we'll just sit there and play cornhole during the day and, or take a nap. You know, just some, you know, just non-stress things to do, or, you know, you can watch a movie or something, but try and keep it as stress-free as possible on Fridays. But
do they provide Wi-Fi there with all of these new fangled accessories, right? Uh-huh. The Wi-Fi thermometers.
Yeah.
Do you guys have Wi-Fi there that you use, or no?
No, that's one thing you probably don't ever go to a competition
relying on that.
Yeah. Relying on Wi-Fi, you won't get it. So make sure you have good cell coverage.
I just carry it with us, being everything so digital. You know, I wondered how far it's gone with the competitions.
Typically, a competition you get 20 amp service. So you don't, I mean, like us, we bring our fifth wheel, or my dad's fifth wheel. So we bring, you know, we want the air conditioner, you know, we're considered.
Yeah, so you have a generator or something that like that.
We run generators for the air conditioning. Make sure you have a fire extinguisher. That's another, there's another check. Sometimes that's about a 50-50 if the competition comes around and checks fire extinguishers.
You kind of keyed me on one thing you mentioned earlier, the inspection. Mm-hmm. So it is my assumption that you cannot prep your meat prior to you can't put a rub on or anything like that, right? They have to see the meat raw. Is it in its packaging, or do you take it out, or how far do we go with these inspections?
Okay, good question. Because in my very first competition, I didn't know you could prep meat at home. So my very first competition, I did all four meets in that one day time period. And that's why I'm saying it gets pretty tough. But
so you pre-prepped them?
Oh,
you were not supposed to? Is that what you're saying? Or
no, I bought the package, you know, bought a pork butt the way it is, how you get out of the grocery store. But that 10-pound pork butt on my cans, I cook hot and fast on my cans with my pork. KCBS rules state that your meat has to be 4 pounds or heavier. So I don't cook 10 pounds pork on one butt. I trim that guy down and I focus on obviously the meats that I'm going to turn into the box. But I trim that 10 pound pork butt down to 4.2 ounces. So with that being said, I do all that trimming at home, put them in food saver bags, food saver it up, put them in the coolers.
And that's obvious, that's allowed. You can do that.
That is okay. Perfectly right. Allowed.
Okay.
So basically once the judges start coming around and they do their meat inspection, they have their clipboard. You got to remember your KCBS number or Rocky Mountain Barbecue Society number. You give them that. Then you open your cooler and they go, okay, can I see your chicken? So you show them your chicken. Can I see your ribs? And you show them your racks of ribs. And sometimes, you know, they're pretty lenient. I mean, you don't literally have to sit there and pull every single meat out of it.
Oh, okay.
I mean, just when you open the visual check. All they want to see is your meat is in raw form. There's no seasoning, no injection, no brining. And once they sign off on it, they'll check you all off. Okay, you're good to go. You could start opening your package and, you know, say for instance that your meat inspection is 10 o'clock Friday morning. You have until 12 o'clock the next day to turn in that food. You could technically, and I know there's guys that don't do it, but technically you could smoke all your food right then and there and then wait till the next day and warm it up and put it in
the bucket. Yeah.
You can do that too.
Do teams do that? I mean, all kidding aside, or no?
No, I haven't seen it.
Unless some special circumstance, I guess. But for the most part, you're turning in fresh, hot food. Okay. Well, folks, that's all the time we have this week. We had Brian Guerrero on the show. And as you've heard, we left off actually late Friday, early Saturday. So tune in next week. We're going to have part two, and we're going to take you to the latter half of competition, talk about those. So this has been Easy Does It Barbecue Show with Dan McDonald. I'm the owner and operator of Colorado Barbecue Outfitters at 5921 North Academy Boulevard. See you next week.
Thanks for listening to Easy Does It Barbecue, brought to you by Colorado Barbecue Outfitters, specializing in pellet grills, charcoal grills, electric smokers, sausage rubs, and barbecue accessories. Online at 719bbq.com. See you next Saturday at 1 for Easy Does It Barbecue. And listen to the podcast on Podbean.